how you feeling?
Feeling great, man. Feeling really good.
Are you a careerist? Do you think about what the context of your work is, or do you just want to do the work?
Good question. I've always been a person who just wants to do the work, I think. And that probably comes from my theatrical background and living in New York, which I still do. That attitude of just like finding interesting things to be a part of and just kind of making it. But I would say in the last couple of years, after Selma and after The Knick and 42, I think that I've maybe become a bit more of a careerist in terms of like, I think I've really got my eye on the direction I want to go in now, more so than I ever have.
So where do you want to go?
Well, I'm really, one thing that's really important to me is doing projects that I feel speak to my community as like an African-American man. Mm-hmm. Being from Alabama, I think that in light of everything that's happening in the world and in Baltimore and in Ferguson and all over the place, I think that we need, the black community needs as many sort of positive witnesses as possible. So that is definitely a part of my like mission. But on a more sort of selfish note, I think that I'm also interested in doing parts that that are just more prominent. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? I mean, I've kind of like made a you know, short career of playing a lot of very supporting parts, which have been really awesome. But mm-hmm. I also really have an appetite to see how far I can go, you know? And so I want to take on some bigger, meatier, juicier parts.
But you've had a chance to in theater.
Yeah, for sure. I've done a lot of stuff, like a lot of Shakespeare, a lot of classic plays, and even some new plays, but I haven't really had a chance to do that kind of work yet on screen. So
by the end of The Knick last season, I think you kind of were stealing the show from Clive.
Thank you. I mean, I definitely benefited from some really like cool and classy writing.
Yeah.
You know? And I had the character that I played, just the way it was written, was so sort of like interesting and different from anybody else in the show. So I benefited from that. But I want to know what it's like to really be like, to really have the responsibility of carrying something, you know, not just as an actor, but also just like as like a leader in terms of the cast and the crew, you know.
Well, that's actually a lot of actors who make that transition talk about that, and you know, how some of them don't like it so much.
Right.
Because it is a lot of response. All of a sudden, you're the one who kind of sets the tone for the day.
Right.
Which I guess is not normally the way it is for you.
Yeah.
On some of these shows.
Yeah, you sort of turn up and like there's someone else who's, you know, who has that voice, you know. And I think it just comes from a place in me of like really just wanting to make sure that I live up to every ounce of my potential, whatever that is, you know. And I think the only way to do that is to really kind of go for it and see how it, you know, see what sticks.
So has it felt like in years past, and say 2 years ago or 3 years ago, like you were just kind of looking for something, looking to work? Or I mean, have you gotten to the point where you feel like you can now make choices?
I mean, I definitely feel like, I mean, I've always felt like I can make choices, you know? I mean, because I always have the choice to say no to something. But I've never been the kind of actor for whom tons of things have, like, come to me, you know? And that's still the case. Like, it's still not like I'm, you know, being overloaded with amazing offers to do things. It's still a hustle to get out there and try to find those interesting projects. So, you know, in terms of the choices, I think the choices now is about, like, trying to find interesting filmmakers to work with, regardless of how, you know, I think it's regardless of how big the part is, if the filmmaker is really good, I think that's it. But then also, like I said before, finding those projects that really give me an opportunity to sort of stretch my wings and see how I do.
So what is your interaction with directors like? I mean, have you found that to be a central part of your work, or do you bring it to the set and then just kind of make the adjustments to whatever the director may want? Or
it depends, you know, it depends. It's a little bit of both. With The Knick, for example, Steven gives us a lot of freedom. You know, we all go away and do our own work, and we come in, and he expects us to come in with our own ideas for what we think the scene should be. So I've definitely done that. But then, like working with Ava, she's very different in that she's like, you know, what do you think? Like, let's talk about it. Let's figure out what we want to do here, you know? So it's a little bit of both. And I think that coming from that theatrical background, I've learned how to adapt to any environment. Do you know what I mean? My own personal taste, I prefer to go away, do my own work, come in and present a proposal. And then if it's the wrong thing, or if it's not, you know, they don't like it, then we can change it from there. That's just the kind of actor I tend to be. I'm not one who sort of waits to be told what to do. I'd rather do it wrong. Do you know what I mean? And then have to like backtrack. But
should you get a different thing from somebody like Ava and then somebody like Steven? I mean, is that a different, ultimately they're both pretty much after the same goal.
Yeah.
And they're both, in some ways, their energy is not completely dissimilar in terms of what they put on camera.
Mm-hmm.
But are you getting fulfillment? You know, I don't know what I'm trying to ask you. I lost myself on some sort of journey that my brain was going on and I couldn't fulfill. But I mean, do you have a preference as to what you get?
Mm.
But is there a, I mean, like if Scorsese called,
mm-hmm.
is there a thing that you would be looking for to get out of that relation, that experience? Is there something you would expect?
I mean, not necessarily. I would make sure that I get something out of it, regardless of who it is. Do you know what I mean? But I don't really, there wouldn't be a specific thing that I would be looking for. Like, for example, with Steven, I didn't know what to expect coming in. But what I've taken from it is that he has this really wonderful way of, like, weaning you off of approval, you know? Because he's not a guy who's going to come up and pat you on the back all the time or say, you know, well done, man, or... You do it, and then like you kind of have to be able to stand behind your choices, which is great because it develops your taste and it develops your confidence, you know.
And then you can start making fun of him.
And then he went, yeah, yeah.
That's how you know you really have Steven where you want him, is that he's mocking you.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
You've read it. So where did this start on the Knick? Did you get just a pilot script, or did you...
Yeah, I didn't even get a whole script. I got a couple of scenes from a script, and they said, we need these to be put on tape right away. I was in Europe at the time, and so I was running around the hotel in Lisbon trying to find somebody who could help me tape this audition, and so found this young English couple who were on their honeymoon and talked the wife into coming to my hotel room. How, I don't know, but I did. her husband was there too, but... So they helped me tape the audition. I sent it in, and then there were a series of meetings and lunches and things that happened once I got back to New York. And then after that, it was pretty quick.
So was there a sense of the arc of where this character was going, or were you just kind of happy to be doing a project with Steven and kind of trusting
that
would be good?
Well, I mean, that was part of it for sure. When I saw who was attached to it, I was like, look at his track record, and you know, you're in pretty good hands. But after the initial audition or second round of auditions, they sent me the whole pilot script, and then I got, you know, all 10 episodes, and so I definitely had a sense of where it was going, and it literally just got better and better and better and better. It was a character I hadn't read a character like that, so well developed, so nuanced, in a very long time.
Well, it does really turn a corner by about halfway through the season. The whole show turns a corner.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's a different, you know, it's like there was one character, you kind of see, people saw the first couple shows, the episodes, and you're like, so there's this guy, mm-hmm. or it's, you know, I'd be longer further along, and I'd be like, "There's this amazing performance," and they'd be like, "What? He's in it a little bit, but by the time you get halfway through the season, all of a sudden, as I say, you're kind of eating the show."
Oh, thanks, man. Thank you.
Well, it's a good thing, but it's like it's actually pretty brave it's unusual for a show to take on those issues.
Yeah,
the show really becomes about race and about class.
It really does
as it goes along.
Yeah. It deals with so many things that we're still talking about today. Like you said, race, class, immigration, reproductive rights. I mean, there's so many things that are kind of subversively laid into the story that are still very pertinent.
So the script was pretty much locked down when you started?
Yeah, all 10 episodes had been written, and what we shot was pretty close to what was written. I mean, there were some changes that happened along the way, but it was pretty close to what was on the page.
And you started your next season. I don't know.
Yeah, we're almost done. We got about another month to go. We wrap on May 22nd, I believe, or 23rd.
Yeah, so I'm following Steven's tweets. So
yeah.
May 75.
Yeah. It's crazy how fast it goes, David. I mean, it's like, it literally feels like we just started season two and we're nearly done. I mean, I think I have maybe 5 shooting days left.
Mm-hmm.
Clive maybe has 7 or 8, but, you know, we're pretty much in the home stretch.
So did you get, again, the whole season at the start of the season?
Yeah, we got all 10 episodes right at the beginning of the year, like first week of January, and then we started shooting later, like midway through January, so we had a few weeks to kind of get our heads around it.
Does it change at all? I mean, is there a bit of rewriting as you go? Or?
Yeah, there's quite a bit. This year in particular, there's been a fair amount of rewriting. And I think that's just a result of, like, there are a bunch of new storylines that are going on this year. A lot of characters who were sort of, you know, in the background who are coming more forward. And so just trying to make sure all the dots connect has been a real feat. So there has been a fair amount of rewriting. And also, from my character's point of view, they've been really awesome about listening to my ideas about where I think the character could go.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been dope, man. It's been really great.
So are writers around, or are they off on some other planet?
No, they're there every single day.
They're there on the set.
Every single, Jack, Michael, and Steven are there every single day from beginning to end.
And Steven's shooting too, right?
Yeah, yeah. When I said Steven, I mean Steven Katz, who's who's the third writer who sort of came in last year to help out. But then Steven's shooting, yeah, he's right. shooting and then like editing on his way home and comes in the next day and he's like, look at what we did yesterday.
So you've done guest spots on this other series, but have you ever done a series for more than an episode or two?
I've done, I did a couple of comedy series that didn't last for very long years ago, mm-hmm. but this is my first sort of like major part on a series that, you know, has been fairly successful.
But just even the experience of going through a season of television.
Yeah.
You never, I don't know, how long did your previous shows last?
The first one we did, half orders. It was like 13 yeah. episodes of each, and but they weren't really, you know, it never really took off to the place where we, you know,
that's my computer.
Oh, yeah.
My phone really doesn't excuse me. It's my son.
Hi. Sweet.
We're still shooting. Can you say? Can you hear?
Hey.
Hi, honey. It's Andre Holland.
Hey.
An interview. Sorry about that.
That's all right, man. No worries.
That's a very rare occurrence. We normally never interrupt at all.
Oh, yeah, that's all good. No worries.
The phone call came through. Anyway, yeah. They were trying to figure out when to get back.
Yeah.
My mistake. So you were on a show that lasted, that did...
We did 13 episodes.
13.
Yeah.
And it was a sitcom?
It was a sitcom, yeah. It was a half-hour comedy for NBC. It was called 1600 Penn. But it was,
which know, Josh Gad now makes fun of Josh. Every episode of The Comedians.
Oh, does he? Oh, yes. I haven't seen it. I haven't seen that show. Though.
Apparently, that's his, you know, his nadir of his success. He didn't become famous. Because I'm thinking 1600 was the thing that was going to make him famous.
Right.
Apparently didn't.
Yeah.
Yeah. He found another way.
Yeah, well, he seems to be doing all right for himself.
Yes. Well, we'll get you in Frozen 2. Everything will be okay.
Nice.
So was that experience of doing, because that was a one-camera sitcom, right?
Yeah.
Is it anything like
no.
the experience of shooting?
No, not even close. This is unlike anything I've ever done. This mm-hmm. is like, I mean, it's the classiest group of people I've ever worked with. And it's like, the level is so high. I mean, everybody in each of the departments are the best, you know? So it's, I kept the feeling of like walking on set and knowing that you don't have to worry about what you're wearing. You don't have to second guess really the words. You don't have to second guess anything. It's all been taken care of. All you have to do is turn up, look the other actor in the eye and say the lines that you're given to say and mean what you say, you know, and so much of the rest of the work is taken care of. It's a wonderful experience, man, truly.
And is it competitive with the other actors? Is there a sense of, because these are, you know, very big dramatic scenes, very intense. Do you guys have a sense of who won the day or any of that?
Not really. Not at all. It's such a generous group of people, man. Like a lot of us will, outside of work, outside of the shooting schedule, we'll get together on weekends and go over our scenes for the week, or we'll stay late sometimes and go over what's coming up. And it's such a collaborative group. And I think it really comes from the top down. I mean, everybody just wants to be the best version that they can be. And I mean that mm-hmm. truly. There's not, nobody comes in with this ego about, well, this is my scene or this is my moment and don't mess up my, none of that. I mean, and Clive, I think, starts it because he's such a kind and generous guy and works his tail off that, you know, we all have no choice but to just fall in line with that.
And Steven likes to just get it and go, right? He's not a lot of takes.
Not a lot of takes. I mean, and I love that. At first it made me nervous because I was like, I've never experienced anything like this. It was so fast. Mm. We would sometimes do one, maybe two takes and he'd be moving on, and I'm like, wait a minute, I'm just getting warmed up, man. I thought we'd get a couple more shots at this, you know. But in the end, I think what that comes from is that he said this to me once. He was like, Andre, I don't see any reason to make things any more complicated than they have to be. Let's just make it simple, you know. And that is another lesson that I'll take from this experience, man. Just what is the simplest version of this thing, and that's usually the most effective.
Well, maybe if we go on a Fincher movie next.
Yeah, let's do it.
And you have a whole different kind of experience.
Yeah,
it's also
yeah.
brilliant, but different.
But different, yeah.
Different journey. Yeah. So, when did this all start for you? Were you a kid actor? Were you a high school actor? Were you?
I did act in high school. My mother started me when I was quite young, kind of as a way to keep me out of trouble. I think I grew up in a you know, working class neighborhood in Alabama, and there was a lot of trouble around, and so she sent me to this program, after school program, about 45 minutes away. And so we sang and held soup cans and, you know, danced and did all that stuff. And that was my first experience with it. And then in high school, I started doing it more heavily. Mm-hmm. And then when it came time to go to college, I didn't really know what I wanted to do. I was a good student, but not a, you know, an excellent student. I had gone to several different high schools and was honestly feeling a bit lost. And I had a drama teacher in high school who sat me down and said, well, you know, what's your plan? And I said, man, I really don't know. And he said, well, have you thought about pursuing acting and, you know, studying it? And I said, I didn't know you could do that. How do you do that? He said, well, I went to Florida State and they have a good program. I think you should check them out. So I went home and told my mom, and she started up the van, and we drove to Florida and took a walk around campus. And she said, well, what do you think? I said, I think I like it. She said, well, let's figure out a way to make it happen. And so they covered the first year, and I went down there and just worked my tail off and earned a scholarship. And that allowed me to stay for three more years, and then moved to London for a year and a half and studied some more and saw a bunch of plays. And
so you went from Tallahassee to London.
To London, yeah.
That's a culture shock.
Yeah, it really was, man. But I did a study abroad program my third year and just fell in love with it. It was my first time out of the country. And it was the first time I felt like a man, to be honest. Like, growing up poor black and in the South does something to you. And when you get out of that and you can see, it's like seeing yourself for the first time. And I remember that, you know? So I made a point, I went back and I lived there for about a year and a half. I took a job as a sort of a counselor for the study abroad program. Mm-hmm. So my job was to organize their cultural calendar. So every week I would take them to whatever play or opera or ballet, whatever I wanted to see. I would take them four nights a week to the theater or to a performance. And then we'd have these discussions about it. And that year and a half was so important to me because it really helped me develop taste, which I think is one of the most important things an artist can have.
Mother is pretty key to...
Oh, she's... Without her, I would not be sitting right here. That's no question about it. No question about it. She's the best woman in the world. Wouldn't take nothing for her.
So from there, you headed north?
Well, from there, then I moved to Paris for about 6 months, and I worked with a theater company out there doing this, like, physical theater. And then I moved to New York and went to graduate school at NYU and got a master's in acting and three year program, finished in 06.
And is that still where they send you to one of the different acting studios?
Well, they do that for the undergrads. They send you either Meisner or Adler or whatever. But in the grad program, you're 16 people and it's just the 16 of you for 3 years. Mm. Yeah.
So what was that intense experience like? That must have been really intense.
It was the most fun I never want to have again. Because it was... I mean, it's like showing up and crying every day and like fighting with your classmates. And I mean, you like, it's crazy. It's crazy. But I learned so much, man. So much.
Well, 16 people for 3 years together, that's a pretty tight company.
It's a very tight. And they're like, you know, anytime I'm doing something, if I have a problem or anything, I text somebody or call somebody, one of my classmates, and right away, you know, they come and help, or I go help them, or we, it's a little family, man. It's a really, it's... And like so many wonderful actors have come out of that program that like sometimes I'll be working and I'll, you know, on set, I'll be like, something about that dude. Like, hey, man, where'd you go to school? NYU. Where'd you go? Same place, man. You know.
So you graduated and you...
So I graduated in 06.
Started working?
Yeah. My first job was Shakespeare in the Park. So I did Much Ado About Nothing.
I think I saw that.
Did you see it? Yeah.
I think so.
Yeah. I was one of the guys in the back with the, you know, the spears. But so I did that. Then I did a play called Blue Door at Playwrights Horizons, which was like a two-hander, which really kind of helped me, you know, get the attention of some of the casting directors and stuff in the city. And then it was just a series of new plays. Man, I a good friend of mine is a writer named Terrell McCraney, who's one of the most fantastic writers around. Mm-hmm. And he and I became really good friends. And so I did a bunch of his plays, did some more Shakespeare in the Park. And then, you know, 5 years later, I got my first sort of big movie part, which was 42.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So did you feel whistled aboard the New York theater scene? Or was that like, that become your family? Did that become the next family? Or was it...
Yeah. Yeah, and it still is, man. Just the other day, you know, before I came out here to LA, I was a friend of mine, one of the new characters on the Knick, actually, is from London, and so she and I were walking around, and she says, oh, well, you know, what's it like theater in New York? I was like, come on, let me show you something. So we went to the Public, and several friends of mine are still there, and so they, like, gave us a tour backstage, and we went on the set of Hamilton, which is, like, the musical everybody's talking about, and again, it was just like, you know, the stage manager, everybody, I knew all of them, because it is that, like, that familial thing. Mm. Yeah.
And then 42 happened. So was it that different? I mean, you'd done enough stuff by then, I guess, in small parts.
Yeah.
That wasn't unusual in terms of the experience, right?
I mean, it still was kind of unusual just because I wasn't really used to to working with the camera, to be honest. I mean, most of what I had done was theater. I'd done a few small parts in TV. Like I said, the 1600 pen and these things, but to be on a big movie set with, you know, a part that was pretty significant, it was definitely nerve-wracking. But what helped is the fact that Nicole Beharie, who played Rachel Robinson, she and I had known each other for years from the theater scene. She went to Juilliard when I was at NYU, so we knew each other. Chad Bozeman and I knew each other, same from the theater scene. So, you know, again, it was that kind of like extended family. So we all just supported each other, and it
And Chad Bozeman's such a mean guy that it must be terrible for you.
Awful.
We saw him a few months ago, and it was like, wow, could there be, every once in a while, meet, like, you know, every few months I meet somebody and I'm like, could there be a nicer person?
Yeah, yeah.
In this business.
I look forward to you saying that about me when I leave.
I will, you know, I'll wait at least 30 seconds. You don't want to butter anybody up too much. Yeah. Something like that. So, I mean, you had done all this stuff, but you had not yet really built a relationship with the camera?
Yeah.
Because you just, because the other stuff was, the machine of television is just kind of moves and you didn't have to, or?
I mean, you know, I think part of it was that I just always thought of myself, I always imagined that I would be a classical theater actor. That's, I mean, all I ever thought was, I'm just gonna go do Shakespeare and I'm gonna do, you know, Ibsen and Shaw, and that's what I'm gonna make my living doing. And it wasn't until, you know, years of doing that I finally started to say, well, maybe I can make a living also doing film and TV. Because to be fair, like when you're in drama school, nobody talks about TV and movies. They're all like, don't do that. Don't go sell yourself. Don't go do that. Mm-hmm. Stick to the classics. But when you come out of school and you have a massive student loan debt, at a certain point, you know, $300 a week at classics, I'm not going to name names, but $300 a week at like a theater, unnamed theater in New York is not going to get it done. So,
and you need an apartment at some point.
Exactly. Like, exactly.
There's nothing cheap about working out of New York City.
Yeah.
Yeah. So now you're rich, you're an easy street.
Man, please. When I said massive student loan debt, I meant massive student loan debt, brother.
Well, it's one of the funniest things about to talk to people, and directors in particular, because they get, you know, people forget they're working on a movie for 2 or 3 years and they get paid a good salary, but it lasts the last 2 or 3 years.
It's not
like, but actors, you know, people assume that everybody's just, you know, rich.
And that is not true.
Yeah.
No, it's not that at all, man. You have to be really smart. You get paid fairly well for one thing, but then you never know when the next thing is going to come. So you have to, you know, and then, you know, there's a lot of other expenses that come along with it. You know, a lot of traveling involved and a lot of support that you need from other people. And so it gets expensive.
And hotel room auditions. Which are
hotel. Exactly.
Extremely difficult.
Yeah.
So do you have a sense of things changing in this process? Did 42 open doors that you didn't expect? Are you getting scripts you weren't getting 2 years ago or a year ago?
Truthfully, not yet. Not yet. I'm hopeful that it will, that more stuff will start coming in. I think that since the Knick has come out, there have been more people who are at least aware that I exist, and you know, and will see me for things or let me read stuff. But you know, it's still, as my family says back home, it's still a hell of a road to hoe. Mm. You know, it's.
Is it different for you when people are recognizing you from the Knick than people when you were on stage? I guess there's
such
a small group of people that are coming to the theater.
Yeah.
Ultimately.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a very small group of people. So it's definitely been the last few months walking down the street, and every now and then someone says, "Oh man, you do from the Knick, right?" It's nice. It's nice to be recognized and for something that I feel proud of. You know what I mean? But hopefully, more people in the industry will watch it, and it'll lead to some more opportunities.
The paparazzi aren't chasing you down the street at this
point. No, man, please, not at all.
Interesting to you, or is it scary in some way, or is it just kind of you're so assuming that it's not going to happen that you're just,
man, I'm assuming it's not going to happen, and also it's like it's not something that interests me at all. It doesn't even cross my mind, to be honest. It just isn't like fame, so that stuff doesn't matter to me at all. Like,
it kind of slowed down for Clive. There was a period where Clive, like, they'd look for any bad picture of him
and they try to
put it up on the web or whatever and be like, why are they doing this poor guy just having lunch you know, picked his nose or whatever.
Right.
Like, they found the one.
I guess, you know, there's a whole industry that's built around that, and those people have to make a living too, and it's, you know, it is what it is. But for me, it's about the work, man.
You're awfully kind.
Oh, thank you. Thank
you. Oh, wait a minute. I'm not supposed to say that until after. But yeah. It's like, oh, the paparazzi, they have a living to make.
I mean, I'm saying that now. Now, if I'm getting chased down the street, I might be, you know, turning to Kanye. But I get it, man. I get it. Everybody's got bills to pay. They've all got a thing they got to do, so.
Have you ever met Kanye?
I've never met Kanye, no.
Have you ever met a Kardashian?
No, sure have. No, no.
It's really not your universe, is it?
It's not at all, man. I'm like, you know, no. No, I haven't actually. I met Obama.
Well, that's pretty good.
Pretty cool, yeah.
Was that at the Selma screening, or is that
something? Yeah, we did a Selma screening and at the White House, and I was like, he's the most charming man I think I've ever met in my life. Next to you. He's the most charming. But he had like seen the show. He had seen the Knick, mm-hmm. which blew my mind. And yeah, he's an incredible guy, obviously.
He was pissed off that week the DVR didn't like, tape it or whatever. People were very upset this week because some show
didn't take
the finale, the last 6 minutes, didn't tape on people's like, DirecTV or something.
Oh, really?
Outrage. On the
Wait,
streets.
The last 6 minutes of what? Of
It was... One of, I Game think of the Thrones.
Oh, the Americans. Okay.
People are very, very upset.
Really?
Wow. On Twitter, at least.
Wow.
See, I get all my news from Twitter now. It's kind of sad. If you're not on Twitter, I have no idea what's going on in your life. But yeah. When you are on Twitter, I know way too much. Do you do any of that? Or are you a social media person?
I'm not, as of yet. Although, you know,
intentionally
maybe,
or just coincidentally?
I think just coincidentally. I'm very old school, man. Like, I'm one of those dudes who still, like, I love handwriting things and... You know, letters and
you
I like
read a paper
actually.
On paper?
Yeah, that's the only way I read it. I can't read it. That's the only way I read it on a paper. You know.
Your New York Times and your
yeah. Hands. I had it this morning, as a matter of fact. Yeah, yeah. I like getting the little ink spots on your fingers. It's the best.
So for you, if there's another 4 years of the Knick or whatever there would be, mm-hmm, three or 4 years of it, and you went back and did theater and started to do the parts more parts you wanted to do, perhaps in a bigger theater that paid more than $300 a week.
Yeah.
That would be pretty happy for you, it sounds like.
Yeah, that would be great.
Sounds like you don't need to have, I mean, you're interested in having other things, but.
No, I'm definitely interested in having other things. I mean, what I don't need is like celebrity, right? I don't need like fame. That's not what I hunger for. What I want though is like to work with the best people on the best projects. That's what I want. And if like fame and celebrity comes along with that, I'm okay with it. As long as it's in service of me becoming a better actor, you know? And the only way to do that, I think, is by working with the best people.
Are there challenges as an actor that you kind of are anxious to do? I mean, do you like being lost in it? Do you want to do, you know, big fake nose and turn into a monster? Or do you want, I mean, are those kind of things appealing to you?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, like I said, that company I work with in Paris is all this like physical transformational kind of acting. And I think that's what I'm best at, frankly. Mm-hmm. You know, I haven't had a chance to do it on film yet, but that's what I really enjoy. But I'm also like, I love like the Bourne movies. And I'd love to like play a character like that.
So like, the physicality of it.
Yeah, the like physicality of it and like a guy who's like has like massive secrets and who's like, you know what I mean? Like mm-hmm. this quiet confidence and that kind of thing really appeals to me.
They come to you and play Joan Allen first, I guess.
Joan Allen, you said, yeah.
Joan Allen's role, yeah. Or...
You know, no.
That would be quite a transformation.
Yeah.
So was your character in The Knick always from France? Was that just a coincidence that you came from there and the character comes from there?
It's total coincidence. Total coincidence, yeah.
But it's also kind of like this weird, different thing going on in the background that kind of shows itself over the show. It's kind of interesting.
Yeah.
Because hearing you talking about working in France, it sounds like...
It's all kind of, well, that's what's
like
interesting, man. Like
the core that nobody gets to see.
Well, so many things, man. Like the Knick that happened also in Selma, you know, I'm from Alabama, from Birmingham. I used to go to Selma as a kid all the time for the commemorative march. So like that. And then 42, where I grew up in Birmingham, I played a lot of baseball in high school. And I played on a field called Rickwood Field, which is the oldest ball field in the country, and was a Negro League field. It's where the Birmingham Black Barons played. And so the character I played in 42 was a character who covered the Negro Leagues, who wrote about, you know, Rickwood Field. And so it's interesting how, like, so many of the things that I've done lately have been, you know, seemingly really related to who I am. So
perhaps not just coincidence.
Yeah, maybe there's some, you know, something at work.
So you're just at this point enjoying it.
I'm enjoying it, and I'm also really hungry and looking for the next thing. Yeah, I'm like enjoying it, but also very ambitious, extremely ambitious.
Extremely ambitious.
Yeah,
I like that.
Yeah.
And is there anything you don't want to do? Is there any line for you where you go and?
I don't want to do things that I feel are an embarrassment to myself, to my culture, or to my family. Things that I feel like reinforce stereotypes that we've seen too much of. I don't want to do those things.
She won't be playing an Indian in an Adam Sandler movie. Huh?
I don't know if they'll cast me as that anyway, but...
Well, you know, if you're not white, you're everything else. That's the way Hollywood has been for a long time.
Yeah.
Do you think it's going to get better? Do you feel like we're moving towards a better place?
I think so. I really do. I'm hopeful. I mean, I think when you look at the performances that, you know, and the actors who are out there, everybody from David Oyelowo to Viola Davis, I mean, so many people are doing such great work. I think it can't help but change. I think it's going to take a real effort, people really creating their own content, and myself included. That's another thing I'm looking to do as well. Mm. But I think eventually those voices will be heard, and there'll be more and more opportunities.
So writing, directing, or both?
Writing right now. Producing, hopefully, but writing especially. I think that's, for me, is the most. I think that's where I can contribute the most right now.
And would you say that your inclinations are towards quote unquote ethnic material, or is it just that it's something that's interesting to you and it might
it's just stuff that's
colorblind?
I think it's just stuff that's interesting to me. You know what I mean? I don't think it's necessarily ethnic material. It's just stuff that is reflective of who I am. You know, and I think the problem that I see is that so much of the stuff that I see on TV and in film doesn't really reflect the world that I live in. You know what I mean? So, you know, when you look at my group of friends or the way I live my life, you wouldn't call it ethnic. It's just, right. It looks like a rainbow. Do you know what I mean? There are people from all walks of life. And so those kind of things interest me.
Well, just that kind of interesting conversation, because like with the situation with Ava this last year, the Academy Awards and all that, you know, like the great next step for Ava in some ways to me is doing something that is, you know, a traditional white Hollywood movie that just happens to be directed by a black woman.
Yeah.
You know, that's not, so that the discussion of color is not really even a discussion at that point.
You just want
to get her skill set.
Well, I think that's the ultimate goal, is you want to get to a place where you just get to work as an artist. And that's not something that's not the first thing that people have to want to talk about. You know what I mean? But I think in order to get to that place, there has to be enough saturation of material out there. You know, you dig, so that it's not just, you can't just point at it and say, oh, well, there's our black movie this year, or there's our, you know, whatever.
No, it's very challenging. I think the same thing is true with the transgender thing with Bruce Jenner and all of that. In some ways, the conversation gets silly at some point, but then it's important that it exists, and you realize how critical it is for people who are transgender to be able to express themselves finally.
Right.
And on the other hand, you want to get past it, because
you don't want it to be a thing.
Assimilation is what not thinking about it is what the goal is.
Right.
Not choosing pronouns for people and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But it's challenging.
It's tough, man. It's tough. But we'll get there. We'll get there. Yeah.
Well, I think people just like go and do their job.
Yeah, I think so. And they accept that like we're all a part of the same thing. You know what I mean? That like movies like Selma are not black history, they're American history. You know, they're part of all of our cultural DNA. You know, and once we accept that, I think we'll stop looking at it as something that's other.
Mm-hmm. You know? And the Knick is very much just history. It's not.
Yeah.
I mean, your role in it and the position in it is significant at, you know, a story about race and about New York at the time and the evolution of New York and all of that.
Yeah.
But it's also it's wider than that.
Yeah.
I think that's what's one of the things that's so great about that show.
Thanks, man. Yeah, it's getting at so many different things, you know.
Yeah.
It really, and race is in there, but it's just one of many layers, you know.
And have you learned how to do any medical procedures yourself?
I could probably, if you cut your finger, I could probably suture it.
Wow.
Yeah.
I was glad you were going to say you could put a Band-Aid on it.
Still working on that, but
so you can do your sutures.
Yeah, we like spent a lot of time with that suture, man. So I think I've gotten pretty good at that. But that's probably the extent of it.
So if I get a bullet in my shoulder, I probably should go to somebody else.
Yeah, you should probably do that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, David.
I appreciate it, man.
It was a pleasure talking to you, brother.
To you.
Thanks, man.
Sorry for the ice cream interruption.
Oh, no worries. No worries at all. Makes me want some ice cream.
We're getting a place down the street.